So when I made the top 25 tools video recently, which has been quite popular, if you haven't watched that and you want to watch it, I'll put a link down in the description to it. One of the recommendations for the tools to buy was some drive punches, which are these punches here for making holes in your leather. There was some discussion in the comments with people saying, oh, you know, I don't use the drive punches, I just use one of the rotary punches, which is this kind of a thing here. And there was some, you know, some discussion about what, you know, whether you need to buy these, when you can buy these, because of the price difference and things like that. And I was saying that I wouldn't recommend these, I do recommend these. So what I thought to do is I'd just make a small video going into some of the reasons, a little bit more depth, why I would prefer these punches here, just in case it's something that you're looking into investing in, or if it's not something that you're used to using. So the first thing to talk about is the price, obviously. Now these drive punches, these are the Tandy drive punches here. Depending on what level of the access you have on the Tandy shop, these are between about £5 and £10 each. They're probably cheaper in America. But if you have the elite pricing, they're about £5. The standard RRP is £10. The gold's about £7, I think. And there's 9 different sizes there. So if you were gonna buy these 9 punches, it'd cost you anywhere between £45 and £90. Depending on what access you had. Obviously you wouldn't have to buy them all if you didn't want to, but if you were going to buy the set, that's what that'd cost you. These rotary punches are available in a whole variety of different prices. You can buy these as cheaply as you know, something like £5 for a really cheapo one. The kind of standard average type ones, you know, made by a company like Draper or somebody like that, they're going to be between about £10 and £15. Tandy also do have one of these, which they've put sort of deluxe rotary punch or something, that's actually about £60. I mean, I probably wouldn't spend £60 on one of these, to be honest. But about £15, something like that, would probably be your average price for one of these. £15, £20, that'd get you a nice one. So there's obviously quite a price difference in the two things. And if you were comparing directly on price, then obviously that's one way that these win out over those, is that they're cheaper. In almost all other ways, which is what we'll have a look at, I prefer these ones. So the second thing to talk about is the range of sizes. Now typically on these rotary punches you're going to get 6 heads that you can dial in, and they're going to vary in size from small to large, and usually they're going to be between about 2 and 5 millimeters. That's the kind of range that you're going to get on the holes. These punches, they go right down to a 00, that's 1.5 millimeters, and they go right up to a number 12, which is 8 millimeters. So you're getting a much bigger variety of hole size there, and I do use all of these for various different things. Different hardware requires different sizes. You know, if you use particular contours and things with big screws, and you might want a big one. If you're doing brogue work or watch straps or things like that, you might want a small one. So the range of sizes is appreciated in these, and you do get a better range of sizes than you do out of a rotary punch. Obviously if the rotary punch has all the sizes you need on, then that's not a consideration, but for versatility there is a better range of sizes in those. So the next thing to talk about is the actual sort of mechanism of the punching. So the way that a rotary punch works is it has a small anvil, essentially, which is usually brass because brass is soft, and the cutting part, the actual punch, closes up on the brass, and in closing those two things together, that's what's making you cut. So that is an anvil style of cut. A drive punch, you're essentially punching through the leather into something underneath. So it's not stopping hard level with the bottom of the leather, it's going right the way through, and I think in many cases that gives you a cleaner cut. What it also does is get away from the problem of where if it hasn't cut through you have to kind of do this wiggling motion to actually get it to cut if it's not quite gone all the way. So if we, on this example here, if we just try this rotary punch, this is fairly thin leather as well, it should click. So you can see I've closed that up, you've heard it click together, that's the tube impacting on the brass. When I open this up, you see that actually that's still sort of clinging on a little bit there, and it's left a plug in the leather because it hasn't underneath, although it's impacted, it hasn't really cut through all of the fibres. So what you end up doing usually with these is you kind of cut, and once you've heard it impact, you end up sort of giving it a little twist like that, and hopefully that then brings it through. But again, you can see there that there's some sort of fuzziness in the bottom of the hole. It's not giving the cleanest of cuts. Again, if I squeeze a little bit harder and give it a waggle, there you can see it's gone all the way through. But again, in the bottom of the hole, there's a bit of fuzziness there. It's not the cleanest of cuts because of how it's done. if we take a punching board like this, you should always punch onto something like a poly board, obviously nothing hard that's going to damage the tool. It can be a pando board, one of the rubber ones, a poly board, a chopping board, something like that. When we put the leather on here, we take the drive punch, what we're actually doing is we're driving right the way through the leather into the board, and that means that we're cutting straight through the bottom of the hole and everything. So it means that we don't have to do any sort of waggling and so on, and it also means we get a very clean cut in the bottom of the hole because we've gone right the way through all the fibres. And that might seem like a small thing, but if you're making, you know, good quality items and these holes may be visible on things, you'll find that you do get a better quality of cut because of this sort of bypass rather than an anvil mechanism. So there's also a longevity aspect to that. As I say, usually the anvils on these are going to be brass because it's softer, but you are essentially, every time you close this up, you're impacting metal into metal, and however soft this anvil part is, that is going to dull the cutting tip on here, which means you're either going to need to sharpen it, or the more expensive ones of these, you can actually replace these tips. You can buy a replacement, screw it out and screw a new one in, but essentially every time you're using it, you are dulling metal against metal as you do that, which makes it more difficult to use over time. With the drive punch, because it's going into a very soft plastic, again, even a plastic like that will dull something over time, but it's not metal, it's much, much softer. Therefore, you're being sort of kinder to the cutting edge on your tool, and you'll find that that stays sharp a lot longer, really. You should also find that the actual quality of the steel is much higher in something like this. Because you could essentially buy a whole rotary punch for the price of one of these, you're going to find that the metal is obviously not as good quality. These should be a much higher quality metal, really, for the price that you're paying. And again, the longevity is then better, and the cut should be better, and it should maintain a better edge. So the next issue is how well it coats with different thicknesses of leather. So if you want to punch a hole in some thin leather like this, bit of calf skin, this will be sort of 1-1.2 millimeters. A rotary punch will obviously punch through this no problem. And what you have to remember is you're only using sort of the power of, you know, your hand squeezing together to do this. But it will, no problem at all, punch through some thin leather like that. Again, it's not cutting very well there. If we move up to this leather that we just tested before there, that's a little bit thicker. That's probably about maybe between 1.5 and 2 millimeters. Again, you know, it will cut okay. It's not too much of a problem. If we start to move on to something quite thick, for example, there's a piece of belt leather here. This will be about 4 millimeters. You're going to start to struggle a little bit with these kinds of leathers. So if we try and punch a hole here in this belt using the punch, I'm going to have to start to really, really uncomfortably squeeze to get that through there. I'm not actually sure I can get that through that leather, to be honest. I don't think that's gone all the way through. The point being that the thicker the leather that you are trying to get through, the more difficult it is with the hand tool, because you just squeeze in there. And if you're using thick belts and things like that, you will find that that starts to get very difficult, because you're obviously using hammering. You can just hammer until it goes through. It's not going to hurt your hand. You can get through even thick leather with it. The only issue you'll get is they sometimes get a little bit stuck in there. You can obviously wax them up and things if you want to, but if we try and get through something like this with the punch, a couple of taps, we can check we're through at the bottom, which we are. And no problem at all, we've gone right through, and there's really no effort involved in that. There's no pain in your hands involved in that, especially if you're a bit older and things like that. So it's certainly much easier to use on thick leather. So the next thing is the throat size. Now, a lot of leather tools, tools in general, are restricted by what's called a throat size. On a tool like this, the distance between the anvil here and the kind of part of the mechanism that closes just there, that would be what's called the throat, and the size of that would be the throat size. And what that means is that when I come to punch a piece of leather here and I insert the leather in there, when the leather hits the back there, that's the limit of the throat. So you can see there on this leather I'm about 4 centimeters in, something like that. I can punch up to 4 centimeters from the edge. So if I want to do something like a strap, like this for example, I can no problem at all get to the middle of that strap. Obviously it's a bit thick, as I've just said, but I can easily get to the middle of the strap. If I want to punch something like, you know, I'm making a pouch or a bag or something like that, and I need to put something that's in the middle of a big piece of leather, let's say for example on this scrap I had a need to put a hole there where that cross is, then that is beyond the throat size of this item. I can't reach it. With a drive punch, obviously you can make a hole anywhere. It's no problem at all to do that. You can place these anywhere in the middle or near the edge and punch that out. Now there is a trick that you can do with a rotary punch, and what you do is whichever size punch you want, rather than having it against the anvil, you turn the punch around so that the one that you want is on the other side, opposite the anvil. And then what you can do is you can place some leather in the jaw there to protect it a little bit. So we place a little bit of leather there, that's just to stop that really slamming into the brass. And then what you can do is, this being the piece that you want to use, you can line that obviously up anywhere as if you would a drive punch. And then what you do is you hit the underside of the tool here with some kind of suitable hammer like this. And what that will do is punch the hole using this. Now, although you can do that, it's not how the tool's designed, and it's really quite awkward to do, to be honest, especially given that you're sort of holding the handle here, you're holding it closed, you're lining that up. It's just a little bit awkward. If this is all you have, you can certainly do that, and it gets around that limitation, but it's much, much easier if you're working on any large items to be able to just use the drive punch properly. So the next thing is a convenience aspect. Obviously, if you have a set of punches like this, you can first of all pick up exactly what size you need and it's ready to go. So you just grab it out of your block and punch if you have them organised. With a punch like this, you need to obviously work out what size you want. Now the sizes aren't even marked on a lot of these. So on my block here, which I made, obviously I have all the sizes marked on. I have the inches marked, I have the millimetres marked, and I have Tandy's own size. They obviously just number these, as I say, 00 to 12. You can grab what you want, you know what size you want, it's the right thing. So I know if I'm putting in a rivet, I'm going to grab the number 2 and so on. With something like this, I don't know what size each one of these is. I can't remember what sizes it came with. Some of them have an indicator on, some of them don't. If you do buy one, I would get one with an indicator. But you know, you then need to dial in which one you want every time. If you want to do one hole and then another, you've got to change it and so on. So they're just not quite as convenient in that sense, really. Also, if you're punching a lot of holes, you'll find that the speed increase with these is quite high, especially if you're doing something like broguing, where you need to punch lots and lots of holes. You can very quickly punch, pull it out, punch, pull it out, punch, pull it out, punch, pull it out. It's taking you a second or something to do each one, obviously a bit more accurately. But with these, again, because you're sort of clicking and giving it a bit of a waggle and making sure it's cut through and putting it back on, they do slow you down a little bit. There are some instances where these do actually work, where the drive punches don't, and that's why I've got a set of these. They don't get used very often, but they are still worth having. Obviously, for the 25 tools video, I didn't recommend both because it was a case of, you know, trying to get essential stuff in there. As I said in that video, in a big workshop, you end up getting a lot more stuff anyway. But where these are very useful is if you have an item and you're not working with your flat pieces, you're actually partway through construction, then these can be very handy for actually getting to certain areas. So if I was making something like a sheath or a wallet or something like that, I'm going to cut out all my flat pieces. I'm going to know from my pattern where I need my holes. And while I've still got flat pieces of leather like this, I'm going to be punching those holes on a board with the drive punch. If you've watched, for example, the messenger bag making video that we did, the turned messenger bag, where we kind of make the bag and then we turn the bag inside out, so we've got obviously something that looks like a bag. Then we start adding on the tabs for the straps at the side and so on. We can't make those holes until we've actually made the bag, because we don't know quite how the leather's going to bend, how the seams are going to meet, how much it's going to stretch and things like that. So at that point, we've actually got a messenger bag and we are trying to make a hole up at the top. Now, you could obviously feed that over an anvil and use a drive punch if you've got a big enough anvil and so on. But if you've got something that's very big and awkward, where these do work well is you can just sort of hold the bag in your lap. You can move, assuming the jaw size isn't a limitation, you can move it to where you need it and you can punch on the item rather than trying to manipulate the item onto a board or an anvil and punch it that way. So that's really where I find these quite useful, is for doing that sort of a thing. So that's it for this video, really. It was just a quick discussion to give you a little bit more in depth the advantages of these kind of drive punches over a rotary punch, if you're still wondering whether it's worth paying for these. It's the kind of thing where if you've never had them and you've always used one of these, and you buy some of those, I would imagine you will wonder why you struggled with one of these for all that length of time. That's my own personal opinion. As it says in all the videos, you are free to choose and use whatever items you want. I don't dictate to people what they should use. It's nothing to do with me, really. It's just what I personally use and find very useful. So just the final thing to say is, if you do decide to buy some of these drive punches, it's worth getting some decent ones. As I say, I'm happy with these Tandy ones. I know Tandy don't make, you know, the most expensive things you can buy, but I found the quality of these to be very good. After I made that video, somebody sent me a comment, and it said they'd got a set of these drive punches off eBay or something, and I think they'd said they'd got 10 for $3 or something, and they seemed a bit rubbish, and did I think that was a bit too cheap? Yes, it is. If you get 10 of these for $3, so they're, you know, 30 cents each or something, they're going to be made out of kind of, you know, ultra Chinese monkey metal, and they're just going to be absolute rubbish. If you're going to buy some, I would at least buy some half decent ones that are going to last you, because you will just end up throwing the other ones in the bin and buying some decent ones. Otherwise, they'll just not get you the results that you want. Okay, hope you found that useful. See you next time.